The court affirms the right of states and police to enforce anti-open grazing law. And on the issue of financial autonomy, state governors Junsun and Passan agree on implementation timelines. This is Cross Politics, and I am Mary Annacombe. The Federal High Court, Abuja, has affirmed the right of Nigerian states to implement anti-grazing laws in their domains. This position weakens that of the Attorney General of the Federation, Abubakar Malami, who had said such a ban was unconstitutional and infringes on the rights of movement enshrined in the nation's laws. Well, discussing this with me this evening is Jiti Ogunye and Monde Ubani, both legal practitioners. Thank you, gentlemen, for joining us.
Thank you for having me.
Great. I'm going to start with you, Jiti. Just like I said in my opening, this position, according to this report, weakens the position of the Attorney General, who said that this type of ban was purely unconstitutional. And I mean, that interview that he did obviously got different kinds of reactions and you know, blowbacks. But walk us through this court order, this new powers that states and police have to enforce the anti-grazing ban in the different states that have said or nodded and okayed it. For example, the southern states who have taken a position already on it.
Thanks for having me. Let me just state up front that it's not the decision of the courts that has weakened the position of the Attorney General. The untenability of the position espoused by the Attorney General was obvious. The Attorney General position was patently weak. And so, before this judicial intervention, logic, common sense, constitutionality, and legal precedents, judicial precedents, all have weakened the position of the Attorney General. The Constitution is oft-cited by lawyers, but sometimes lawyers may not want to look at the dictates, particularly if they want to engage in sophistry. Three sections of the Constitution are very important. All the sections are important, but three sections are very, very important. And that's section 4, 5, and 6. Section 4 defines the legislative powers of the Federation and the states. 5 defines the executive powers of the Federation and the states. Section 6 defines the judicial powers of the Federation, enumerating the courts and all that. Now, by virtue of section 4, every house of assembly of a state has the legislative competence to legislate within that state. And insofar as the subject of this legislation is not contained in the exclusive legislative list, meaning an item within the legislative domain of the National Assembly, the State House of Assembly can legislate. And so what we're talking about basically is the use of land. The Land Use Act makes the governor of a state the trustee of the land of a state. So much so that even if federal government, central government, were to need a land in a state to carry out a federal project, it will have to request of the state for a parcel of land to use for its projects. That's why the federal government saved the land in the Federal Capital Territory and some other federal lands, you know, all over the country, does not have the lands of its own. So grazing is about use of the land in the state. It's about land use. And so it is within the legislative competence and executive competence of a state government to say, this is how we want lands in our state to be used. And I know that the argument has been there. They have to reference Section 41 of the Constitution, which guarantees the right to freedom of movement. But hey, that section is contained in a whole chapter called the Fundamental Human Rights, guaranteed by the Constitution, enshrined in the Constitution. I am not told that any section in that chapter, which is chapter 4 of the Constitution, guarantees the right of a coward. Say section 43 that guarantees the right to own movable and moving property. So if you consider a cow to be a property, every Nigerian has the right to own a cow. But say that section 41 that governs the right to freedom of movement does not help the Attorney General's argument that under that section, every herder, every nomad is entitled to pass about all over the country, is permitted to destroy the vegetation and farm produce of farmers as he likes, and that is protected by that section. And that if the state governments want to intervene, they should first go to the National Assembly to seek the amendment of the Constitution. That argument is wrong-headed. It's not an argument that anybody should even celebrate. So before judicial affirmation of the right of the state to legislate on the subject, and the police and the law enforcement machinery available to the state should help the state enforce that law, I think that the position of the Attorney General, you know, was patently weak, and the Attorney General ought not to have moved that position at all. And secondly, and one call, here is an Attorney General Federation who should be very interested in peace, law enforcement, order in the country. As the Chief Law Officer of the Federation, he should be concerned that under the pretext of herding, under the pretext of taking cows about, foreigners from far-flung places like Mali, Niger, Mauritania, Senegal, are invading Nigeria with their arms. Government authorities have affirmed this. So if cows will have to be ranged to ensure that people don't bear arms and saturate our forests with their arms, why shouldn't any reasonable person applaud that kind of thing, banning open grazing? So on all scores, the Attorney General's position, you know, was dead on arrival, and it is good that the court has pronounced on the lawfulness, on the constitutionality of each House of Assembly of the state banning open grazing.
All right, thank you, Barrister Jiti. I'm going to come back to you, but let me go to Barrister Mondobani, because there were arguments that were raised, and I watched that video over and over and over again because I was trying to make sense of it all. But he did make a comparison that I'm still trying to understand between spare part dealers and these people who trade in cattle or who rear their cattle and move about within areas. Now, Barrister Bani, I'm asking if I understand the spare part dealers have to rent a shop, they have to pay the landlord, and that gives them the right to, you know, run whatever business they're running within that shop. And if they decide to change the modus operandi of their business, they still have a right to come back to their landlord to say, well, I want to change that business in case that's not what he wants his space to be used for. But comparing that to cows and cattle that are being taken from place to place, what is the basis for that comparison? I wish it was, you know, the Attorney General I was asking this question, but is there really a basis for that comparison, being that one person is paying rent for space that he or she is being using, and this other person is walking around free and grazing wherever he wants, and as a result of that, farmlands are being destroyed? So is there really a basis for that comparison?
Well, thank you. You said it rightly, that that question should have appropriately been addressed to the Attorney General who made that assertion. I must tell you that I'm still in shock when I listened to that particular argument that was put forward by the Attorney General of the Federation and the comparison that he just analyzed. You know, the position of things is that when we people, some people have been saying it, that it's obvious that the government is clearly in support of what is playing out recently, where some herdsmen have taken over the farmlands of many Nigerians, and in the process, you know, killed many. In some instances, women are raped. In some instances, people who challenge them on what they're doing on their lands are, you know, being killed, and nothing is being done. And I also have understood that when those people make a report to the police, that the police look the other way and nobody makes any arrest concerning what has been going on. In other words, there is a tacit approval, you know, from the government authority, you know, of what is playing out, you know, in our country. Now, for an attorney general who happens to be the chief law officer to have made the statement that he made the comparison that he did, you know, it is so shocking. It's so clearly unbelievable. Now, in the case of a person who rents a shop, when you want to rent a shop, you will approach the owner of the shop and you will negotiate about the rent for you to pay. And of course, you must also enjoy that facility without any causing of any problem in the property you are using. You are not supposed to kill. You are not supposed to rape. You are not supposed to do any damage. You have to pay before you use somebody's property. Now, compare it to a situation where somebody who says is a herdsman, you know, comes into your farm without any permission whatsoever, without any grant from you, and then ensure that he damages your farm produce. Everything that you have labored for the entire year, he brings them down. And not only bringing them, he also makes sure that if you raise any objection whatsoever, that your life is clearly in danger. He beats you, he rapes you, he kills you in the process. And it's been going on. And there has been this crisis all over, you know, both in the north and in the south. And people have been saying, look, why would government, you know, stand akimbo and allow such a thing to happen? That something has to be done. And the southern governors all came together and said, look, we must reinforce the fact that we have banned open grazing, that there are a better way of, you know, tending to cows, and that is by way of ranching, and which is actually a more modern way of doing that. But that issue of open grazing have caused so much harm and damage, and then have even threatened the unity of this country. And they have taken that decision, which they have a right, as GTR said, you know, to do it or not, according to the section of the Constitution that is there, that has been provided for the State House of Assembly to enact a law, you know, governing an area they have jurisdiction. And they have jurisdiction concerning the land they have in their state and all that. And for you now to come openly and now make the comparison that he did, I am still in shock. I'm telling you that many Nigerians have started to doubt even the ability and competence and capacity of people who call themselves senior advocate of Nigeria, who cannot, you know, in any way make a very solid argument and convince people with logic and law. Because the law he cited on the issue of free movement, as GT has rightly pointed out, that particular section is meant for human beings. The fundamental human right as provided for in Chapter 4 is for Nigerian citizens and not for cows. Cows have no fundamental human right to protect under the Constitution. And in any case, cows that does damage to somebody's farm produce, you know, this is my farm, this is my property that I have owned, this is my property I have a right to farm. You now come in with your own cows and destroy it. You are infringing on my right ownership to property. You are infringing, you are violating the provision of the Constitution that gives me right to my own property. Meanwhile, you are asking me now not to allow your cow that has no fundamental human right whatsoever guaranteed by the law to come and damage my property. I shouldn't take any decision concerning such a violation of my right. I can't fathom it. We have seen cows invade schools. We have seen cows invade hospitals. We have seen cows become kings in many places, especially in Abuja and all over the place and all that. And nothing has been done. It's so irritating. It's so annoying. It's so provoking that we're allowing such a thing in this 21st century where we are still carrying animals on the road, on the street. Sometimes if you are passing, you are driving on the road, you begin to pray. You know, there must be a, you know, prayer. You have to offer not to be attacked by cows on the road. Where is that happening except in Nigeria? We're saying that we have to actually tell ourselves that we are a civilized nation and enact law that would govern us here. And somebody now says, one, there was this argument that he didn't consult the Fulani herdsmen before making that decision. I don't know whether there is any such right for you to consult any person before you enact a law that governs your jurisdiction. The second issue now is that it's unconstitutional. And you couldn't cite a proper section that actually covers him in that particular argument. So I'm really still in shock that the Attorney General could say what he said and make the comparison that he did. It'd be, you know, clearly contrary to all logic and law and even the constitution that he cited.
Okay, back to you, GT. Court has said again that they are rejecting a suit that was seeking to compel the president to direct security agencies to enforce Benue open grazing prohibition and ranching law of 2017. Now, when I looked through it, I was wondering to myself, do we need the president to be compelled for this laws to be enforced? Is it not the duty of states to adjudicate? I mean, if I'm using the right terminology here, should a president have to do that? Because this is already law. It's not a bill. It's, you know, it is a law that is already existing. So do you need the president to be compelled for that law to, you know, be enforced?
Ordinarily, you don't need to compel the president to discharge his executive functions. But times are different. And therefore, I am of the considered view that I do not agree with that part of the judgment of the Honorable Judge that I just delivered the judgment. The reasoning in that portion of the judgment was that that duty is a constitutional duty, and any breach thereof is curable or sanctionable by the National Assembly through an impeachment or removal from office process, and that therefore that relief being sought to compel him to discharge the functions of his office with regards to that law in Benue State is not justiciable. With profound respect to the judges, I believe that the court was trying to be evasive, trying to dodge, you know, a very controversial issue. Look, by law, and that's by an order of mandamus, a public duty by a public officer, including a public office holder, that is not being discharged, can be compelled to be discharged by an order of mandamus. So here we are, every state in the country, every state governor, and this has become a cliche, does not have the power, so to speak, to command the police in the state to do certain things. The commander-in-chief of the armed forces, including the police, is the president. He is the one who appoints the IGP. The IGP directs the commissioner in the states. So if the president, for example, for political differences, and for his aversion to the policy that was banning open grazing, or in particular, his aversion to the enactment of that law, would not want the police to help the state to enforce that law. He could sabotage the enforcement of that law. And given the way that law is couched, it will require physical enforcement, rigorous and vigorous enforcement to ensure and guarantee compliance.
Right, so
it will require physically
police...
taking cows from
I'm sorry,
the farm
I'm sorry
to do that.
Are you telling me that the police has to be compelled or needs an order by Mr. President to enforce laws which they're ordinarily supposed to enforce? I mean, if the law has it stated already, why do you need an order from Mr. President if your job constitutionally is to enforce laws?
I started by saying that ordinarily that should not be the case. But we know that for political reasons, the police can be told not to do anything. It's happened in this country before. The police can be told to do certain things and not do certain things. In Anambra State, in the Igige era, one AIG under Obasanjo regime kidnapped a governor. It happened in this country. So if the police were told not to do certain things from Abuja, you just hear order from above. The Ondo State government have no such problem because it's using Amotekun to enforce all the reports emanating from Ondo State concerning all those, you know, cows that were moving all over the place. Amotekun call is the body that is responsible for the enforcement, then a state may not have that capacity. And so if they have recourse or they have recourse to a law court, the Federal High Court, to compel the president, to seek to compel the president to ensure that there is compliance, I think that that relief is justifiable in the circumstances. But as I've said, ordinarily, the police ought not to be told to enforce the law. The executive arm of government enforces the law. But the instrumentality of enforcement, civil enforcement, is the police force. Is the police force. And so if the police in a state whose commissioner is appointed from Abuja is given an instruction not to put his men and officers at the service of a state that is insisting on enforcing that kind of law, I'm telling you that the state governor will be lame ducked. Okay. He will not have any power to force the police in the state to so, you know, enforce that law. And so in those circumstances, that governor will be right, other stakeholder will be right to seek a specific relief to compel the police to act in those circumstances. That's the point I'm making.
All right. Well, finally, Barrister Bandi, because we're almost out of time. Southern states have said that they have insisted, as a matter of fact, that they're not going back and that the ban on open grazing in those states that have okayed it is irreversible. But just as Barrister Jiti has said, we seem to be politicizing this whole issue. And you have also made an assertion that we seem to be speaking on certain issues and, you know, not paying attention to the others. If, for instance, you know, the states have said this ban is irreversible, and then a party that is in support of Mr. President and this and their stance on open grazing finds their way back into government, do you think that this is going to be reversed one way or the other? And what can they do to make sure that maybe for states that do not have these open grazing laws, what do they need to do so that it is marked in stone or carved in stone so that another governor doesn't come in and say, you know what, let's jettison this and then we have another reoccurrence? In closing.
The state government have not enacted a law with regards to the issue of open grazing.
I think that we lost connection with Barrister Bani, so I'm just going to bounce that question back to Barrister Jiti just quickly because we are out of time.
Now, what my learned friend is saying is that the states that are yet to enact their own respective laws, you know, prohibiting open grazing, have a duty now, persist to go do that, so that there will be a law, specific law, banning open grazing. But my view to cap it all is that even if a state government, you know, does not enact that specific law, under the Land Use Act, the Land Use Committee in every state can issue a policy and say, in this state, open grazing will not be permitted. And I think that that will suffice. It's not at the drop of every hat that you just enact a law. Otherwise, our status quo will be clogged with tons and tons.
But Barrister, you know that we live in a country that every single thing is politicized, including the fact that lives are being lost to banditry and cattle rustling. But if you say that a certain group of people can just say that this is what we should, this is our stand under the Land Use Act, I mean, it's a word of mouth, and it can be changed if a governor...
No, it's not a word of mouth. It's an executive order. It's a policy. It's not a word of mouth. And if within that context, specifically, a herdsman then commits murder in killing, the criminal code takes care of him. He commits other offenses, the criminal code is there. But as a policy, a state government can say, in this state, by virtue of the Land Use Act, this is how we want land to be used in this state, and this is what we're going to do. I think that will suffice. Any right. time they may make a legislation. It may be good to make that legislation, but I don't think that that's just the talisman that will end all this crisis.
Well, thank you very much. Jiti Ogunye and Monday Obani are both legal practitioners. Thank you very much for speaking with us. We appreciate it.
Yes, my pleasure. Thanks for having me.
All right. Well, thank you all for staying with us. We'll take a short break now. And when we return, the issue of Junsun and financial autonomy is up next for discussion. Stay with us. We'll be right back.